Welcome everybody to the last of the Utsun lecture series for 2013. I'd like to pay my respects to the Bendigal people, the traditional custodians of this land, and all that that stands for, and also really welcome colleagues, friends, people who have joined us over the last 6 or 9 months of these lectures on what has been a very, very good series, we think. Tonight is very special because we are going to hear about the Opera House and its legacy from one of our most distinguished architects, Professor Richard Johnson, who is a professor of practice at this university and indeed also a graduate with first class honours in the class of 1969, who went on to UCL in London to get his Masters of Philosophy in 76, and is a gold medalist of the Australian Institute of Architects 2008, and a life governor of the Art Gallery in New South Wales, where he did the Asian galleries. And you may also know other buildings of his, the National Portrait Gallery, the Museum of Sydney, and Governor Philip Tao, which he did as a director of Denton Corker and Marshall before he founded Johnson, Pilton, Walker, the Hilton redevelopment, the War Memorial in Canberra, and of course, working also with Jan Utzon, Jorn Utzon, and in fact Jan Utzon, bringing Utzon back into Sydney's Opera House to develop the master plan for what is the continuing development of the Opera House in 1998. And of course, he's also very significant in the life of Sydney with his roles on the City of Sydney Design Advisory Panel and the Public Art Panel, and also on the board of Australian Technology Park. So with our concluding lecture for the series, I really think we have no better person to give it than somebody who will end the year with where the lecture series really started, with Jan Utzon. Two years ago. So welcome to give the lecture, Richard Johnson.
Thank you, Professor Zarns. Thank you all for coming. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, it's indeed a pleasure to talk in the last of the Utzon lecture series for this year about a subject that we all know a lot about but have yet to learn much from. I'm indebted to a number of people and sources of information over a long period of time, and I just want to mention a few of those people and sources. I think, first of all, Professor Richard Weston's seminal book on Utzon, published in 2002, Building a Masterpiece, the Sydney Opera House, edited by Anne Watson, the work of Professor Paolo Tombesi from the University of Melbourne for research over quite a number of years into the impacts of the Opera House on the construction industry, Blondel Publications for their continuing detailed and marvellous editions on Utzon's buildings, Associate Professor Adrian Carter, who was instrumental in establishing the Utzon Centre in Aalborg, Philip Drew for many books, articles on Utzon over many decades, Rick LaPastria and Peter Myers, who have worked so closely with Utzon in those early years, Joseph Skrinsky, Chair of the Sydney Opera House Trust and instrumental in the reconnection with Utzon, Jan Utzon as a constant source of inspiration and knowledge. And I particularly I'd like to acknowledge my partners at JPW, who have really allowed me to indulge my interests and supports for Utzon and his building, and for the many talented and dedicated staff who have worked with me on the project, with Jan and Jorn, from 1998 till mid-2010. I think my dear wife, Maureen, who gave me the support and courage I needed for this project. And above all, to Jorn Utzon, for all the privileged discussions and insights for over 10 years in both Mallorca and Denmark. All the buildings in this image will one day be long gone when one still remains as a powerful symbol of place and culture. It is one of the most remarkable examples of the power of 20th century architecture to capture the spirit of a people and a place. It is some 57 years, surprisingly, and that's more surprisingly what Sydney looked like then, since the competition for the Opera House was announced in December 1955 to replace the tram shed on Benelong Point. The competition winners, Jorn Utzon, in collaboration with Eric Anderson, were selected from 233 entries and announced roughly a year later. In March 58, the Red Book was presented, and it realised the vision in more detail of the competition entry. In January 62, the Yellow Book was submitted. This included more developed drawings and the three-dimensional solutions for the shells, precast tile lids, tiling, glass walls, and proposals for the major and the minor hall. In February 1966, Utzon withdraws from the Opera House project under complex circumstances, with the shell roofs almost complete, but little work commencing on the interiors. Stage one, the platform, being completed between 1957 and 63, and stage two, the roof, from 63 to 67, at a total cost of a very modest 18.4 million. In March 66, a protest rally organised by the Utzon in Charge Committee with the University of New South Wales architectural students, quite a strong contingent, and a voice of protest was staged. In May 1967, Elias Stewart Cohen, a senior lecturer from this university and a founding member of the Utzon in Charge Committee, published a statement in the public interest. A number of prominent architects lobbied the government to retain Utzon on the project. The profession as a whole was divided, it's sad to say. Utzon left the country, never to return, and in true operatic style, it seemed that a spell had been cast over the site. Stage three was completed between 67 and 73 at a cost of 80.4 million by Hall, Todd and Littlemore, bringing the total cost at completion to 102 million. It's almost four decades now since the building was opened in October 1973. And in that time, I think the controversy of the events that led up to the removal of Utzon from the project have not really abated. But more optimistically, in the history of the Opera House, the past decade has been of particular interest. It's been a time when the building and its site is increasingly used as a place of celebration, and I think, importantly, a place also of protest. A time in which Utzon was reconnected with his masterpiece, having been reappointed architect in the late 1988. This is the ABC interviewing him in his house in Mallorca. a time of growing recognition of Jorn Utzon's importance in 20th century architecture. King Carlos of Spain, in presenting the Pritzker Prize, particularly mentioned two modest houses that built by Utzon for himself and family in Mallorca that showed the Spanish architects how to reconnect with their landscape and their traditional building construction. It is also a time when a major exhibition entitled Jorn Utzon, the Architect's Universe, was staged by the Louisiana Museum of Modern Art in Denmark and proved to be amongst the most popular exhibition ever staged by the museum. By public demand, it had to be that the exhibition programme was extended by an additional few months. These are just some of the images of this marvellous exhibition. It gives, I think, quite an idea of the breadth of Utzon's work and his thinking. It was a time also in which a comprehensive set of documents, it was a time that the first definitive book on Utzon's work, approved by him, every page was laid out by him. This was happening in Mallorca while I was meeting frequently with him. He laid out every page in this book. He checked every word. This is the first book published on Utzon with his intimate involvement. And since then, there have been many more publications which give greater insight into his work. It was also a time in which a comprehensive set of documents have been prepared which will set the framework for and guide the building's future. Getting right out of sequence here, I'm sorry. A time when the first interior by Utzon was opened and named the Utzon Room in his honour, complete with tapestry to his design. A time when the Queen of England opened a modest extension to the building and praised Utzon's contribution, in contrast to the opening ceremony in 1973 when he wasn't mentioned. A time when Utzon developed his ideas for a new opera theatre, addressing the functional, acoustic, sight line, stage and stage machinery problems of the current theatre, and the work was summarised in what's known as the Goal Book of 2005. It was a time when the status of the building as one of the masterpieces of 20th century architecture is consolidated by the UNESCO World Heritage listing of the building in its setting. I think the Sydney Opera House is now undeniably and universally recognised as the icon of Sydney and indeed Australia. It's an inseparable part of our city and our harbour landscape. As Norberg Schütz said in 1996, in the Sydney Opera House, Jorn Utzon realised the great synthesis of the earth and sky, landscape and city vista, intimacy, thought and feeling in terms of unity of technology and organic form. It's an important and critical part of the diverse cultural life of the city. It illustrates the power of a design based upon common elements which are all related, geometrically defined, able to be produced industrially, but maintaining organic and poetic freedom of form. It is an exemplar of organic order as Gideon and others have remarked. Utzon's work displays that rare capacity of combining organic with geometric form and of creating the former out of the latter. In this way, it is inspired by and reflects nature. It's an example of the creative use of technologies, many of them way ahead of the time. In July 2007, it was inscribed on the World Heritage List by UNESCO as a masterpiece of human creative genius. There can be no question that we've been gifted an extraordinary, rich legacy. This lecture will, in part, attempt to sketch the many dimensions of this legacy and inquire what we have learnt from it as a city and a profession. The Opera House is a core part of the nation's and this city's cultural fabric. It is one of the world's busiest performing arts centres, with 1,795 live performances last financial year. Its ticket sales underpin the viability of some of the nation's most important performing arts companies. Its demographic and social economic reach of its audience is extraordinarily broad. As a multi-company performing arts venue with 7 performing spaces, it encourages new and innovative cross-disciplinary art forms. The strength of the ticket sales, irrespective of the event, that is because it's simply the Opera House, enables the performing companies to stage more adventurous repertoire, contributing significantly to the artistic development of the company. The building in its harbour setting has been a source of inspiration for all who seek excellence. It inspires and encourages performers in many different art forms to seek high standards. It develops and keeps local talent, musicians, singers, actors, here rather than searching abroad. It attracts the world's best performers to visit. Many of these would not otherwise come. For example, one of the world's best orchestras, the Vienna Philharmonic, first performed in the concert hall in 2006, their first time to this region of the world, simply came here to perform in the Sydney Opera House, and was so delighted by the warm response, the ability to play in the hall, and the first live simulcast of the performance on the forecourt to an extraordinary audience, that they came back again in 2011. And that's just one example. It's the source of inspiration to some of our finest artists, to Lloyd Rees, to Brett Whiteley, to Martin Sharp, Peter Kingston, and photographers like Max Dupain and David Moore. It's had a great influence on some of our best architects. It remains a rich source of study for architectural students. It's an important part of the tourism infrastructure. More than 8 million people visit from Australia and around the world each year. In 2008, a Commonwealth Government report, roughly at the time of the World Heritage report, estimated that the Opera House contributed $758 million per annum in direct and indirect income, and contributed over 12,000 direct and indirect jobs. The building and the original vision of Utzon was a catalyst for the development of a number of new technologies which have had significant impact on the construction industry. And in this, I acknowledge the many who have had a pivotal role on the building and the development of these technologies other than Utzon, but inspired by the work of Utzon, O'Varrop and Partners, Hall Todd & Littlemore, manufacturers such as Ralph Simons, Monier, Hoganis, and the many other contractors, Hornibrook and others. It's interesting to note that the use of computers in three-dimensional structural analysis was pioneered by Arup, who created the software unique to these applications using the most advanced computers available anywhere in the world at that time. And the work led to computer applications in structural development in the European community and also in the UK and eventually to here. Arup were a founding member of the UK Construction User Group in computers. This work was carried on in recent refurbishments as part of a pioneering group of practices around the world using early BIM applications for design, documentation and structural analysis. And through this early work, my own practice and Arup jointly won an international acclaim and recognition from the AIA, American Institute of Architects, BIM Award. And this early work is now being built upon by the Sydney Opera House, and they're integrating a BIM approach into their internal systems and requirements for future projects. These drawings were generated to analyse the as-built stresses in the shells. There were considerable advances in concrete technology. The use of pre-stressed beams in buildings, although the technique was developed in the early 20s, had been used mainly in bridge construction. And the Opera House was an early use in building and introduced a number of innovations unique to the building. It was the first building to use high tensile steel cable in those marvellous 49 metre span concourse beams. And the beams were held against a buttress to reduce long-term creep in the tensile member by maintaining compression in the beam. There are a number of cement grouts that were developed by research, unique research, that led to their widespread use around the world in the building industry. The main shell segments were cast with matching faces and epoxy glued, and this was a first application of this technique in the world. Again, a pioneering technique. Concrete finishes, like the buffing of early stripped formwork surfaces in the northern foyers, were an Utzon invention, and they aligned the wet mica particles in the surface of the form, lightening the colour of the concrete, slightly marbleising it. Absolutely extraordinary. Next time you're there, look at them. Absolutely extraordinary finish. We were fortunate enough to experiment and to learn from that and re-clean and restore the beams in the Utzon room, and Trevor Waters is principally responsible for that work. In plywood technology, the Sydney Opera House capitalised upon significant Australian advances that already existed and adapted them for use in stage three. Ralph Simon's plywood technology was the most advanced in the world in the 1950s and the 1960s. It was manufacturing the largest sheets of plywood in the world, 15 metres by 2.7 metres. It was using them for train carriages. Simon's product, PlasPly, was almost exclusively used, a unique product, almost exclusively used for quality off-the-form concrete. Simon had developed techniques for shaping ply to tight radiuses. He innovated with hot bonding of metals to the ply to improve their structural and weathering performance. An early product that some of you may remember, alum ply, bonded aluminium, but later he developed techniques for bonding other metals such as bronze, copper, lead and zinc. Simon's also was one of the first to use laminated plywood as a structural element in building. The factory in Homebush, that you can see here, was the largest single industrial building in the Southern Hemisphere, covering some 5 hectares, with structural laminated ply portal frames. Utzon was quick to see the potential of this technology and integrated and had developed it for construction of stage three of the house, for walls and ceilings, joinery for cloak rooms, toilet partitions, the auditorium walls and ceilings, and the mullions for the glass walls. Plywood was used in the formwork for those marvellous folded concrete beams in the concourse. Large laminated structural panels for the auditorium with lead as a bonded layer to provide mass for resonance of low frequencies and sound insulation from harbour noise. Tight radiused mullions, hot bonded with an outer weathering layer of bronze, were developed and prototyped for glass walls. A system of ply panels and ceiling beams were developed as a standardised system to line the different shapes of service corridors in the vast podium areas. The use of ply was further developed in the recent refurbishment of the box office toilets. In 1962, at the height of his involvement in the Sydney Opera House, Ralph Simons, interestingly, was a co-sponsor of the solar furnace developed by the UNSW Department of Physics. It was used until 1970 for investigating materials at very high temperatures and was one of the first UNSW projects using solar energy. Innovations in construction techniques were also quite extensive, and just to mention one, the moving arch, because the geometry of the building was from a single sphere, it was possible to make a steel arch of the same geometry as the shells and move it in advance of the precast elements, thus eliminating formwork. It was the first large-scale use of laminated glass in the world for walls and roofs. So over the many years of the design and construction of this building, the site was a rich training ground for countless architects, engineers of all disciplines, contractors, manufacturers, fabricators, artisans, who acquired inspiration and skill that benefited the industry in Sydney, Australia and the world. There were also innovations more recently in conservation management. The conservation management plan written by James Semple Kerr was the first plan of a World Heritage building written with the full input and approval of the original architect. Together with the design principles, the strategic building plan, and the World Heritage statements, these documents are an innovative way of managing a significant heritage building. The Opera House also had an innovative form of funding at the time. A public lottery was started in 1957 and certainly was a very successful and early innovation in funding for public projects. In fact, the funds were always there in advance of their being required on site. The significant legacies also, I think, to architectural thinking and practice. Central to Utzon's approach to architecture are a number of ideas or principles which I think have had a profound effect on architecture and will continue to do so as his ideas are better studied and understood. As we know, He drew extraordinary inspiration from nature. He believed architecture and nature shared common roots. He had a sensibility to nature as a source of insight and inspiration. I quote, "My laboratory is the beach, the forest, the sea, and the seascape." The logical structures and forms found in nature were also a source of inspiration. I noticed he'd had a copy of Carl Blossfeld's book of photographs, marvellous photographs, on his bookshelf. The way organic structures related to site conditions modifying themselves to adapt to climate was also a preoccupation in his thinking. The infinite variety generated by a limited number of elements in nature led to his theory of what he called additive architecture. He was influenced by D'Arcy Wentworth Thompson's 1917 classic on growth and form. Thompson, as a mathematical biologist, applied mathematical and physical methods to analysis of biological form. Jørn Utzon's observations from nature became poetic metaphors for elements in the design. The podium was the landmass, and when one senses its scale against the other headland masses, indeed, it is a headland. The shells were inspired by clouds, responding to constantly changing light. As he observed the castle at Helsingør near his house, this observation led to the alignment of the two major halls at different angles to ensure different light conditions on adjacent shells, reinforcing their geometric and sculptural quality when viewed in the round. He saw the shell structures like palm fronds, the glass wall mullions like birds' wings cascading in overlapping sections, the auditorium and shell separation like a walnut and shell, the unfolding colour of a peacock from a controlled colour at the neck to the dramatic fanning of colour as the feathers expand towards the tail, to describe the use of colour in the auditorium as it reduces, as it moves towards the stage. To the observation of endlessly varying repetition of waves, waves to inspire and describe the controlled an evolutionary character of the auditorium ceiling based upon cylindrical geometry, decorated integrally to the material and form. It is worth quoting in full Utzon's own words, published in Zodiac: "The invisible wind works up the water, forming the surface into waves, varying winds, varying waves, but always of the same character. The character, the style, has developed from a series of shapes in combination, all with the characteristics of water, waves, waves within water, the waves that breaks, foams. In my thoughts, I mould the invisible space with geometrically defined shapes in combination, and when I have established the void I want, I freeze the situation in my mind. Because I have moulded space with geometrically defined shapes, the whole enclosure of the void is fully defined, and the surface of the enclosure is divisible in a number of similar elements. These similar elements can be mass-produced, and when their relationship has been clarified, they can be assembled like a big jigsaw puzzle in space. Everything that can be emphasized, that can emphasize this idea, must be shown. For instance, the method of production, the erection sequence, the color, decoration, must be as organic a part of this complex as the white foam is part of the waves, in order to achieve a complex and consistent character." He has taught us much about human experience. Utzon believed architecture demands an understanding of life, walking, standing, sitting, lying comfortably, enjoying the sun, shade, appealing to all the senses, not just sight. The beginning and the end of the design was about how it would be experienced. The beginning and the end was not about form making, but human experience. We see it in everything he did. Again, I quote, "On the road from the first idea, the final sketch, to the final building, a host of possibilities arise for the architect and the team of engineers, contractors, and artisans. Only when the foundation for choice between the various solutions derives from the awareness that the building must provide the people who are to live in it with delight and inspiration, do the solutions to the problems fall like ripe fruits." We see this thinking about human enjoyment of space strongly evident in his drawings and in the design of Kingo and Fredensburg houses. We sense in the drawing how a family will live in and enjoy the house. Look at the boat being built in the outbuilding. Look at the children playing. To the organisation of the site plan of Fredensburg housing, seen as fingers of space, we see it obviously in the furniture and product design, which was quite extensive. Here shown in the Louisiana exhibition that I talked about. In his early drawings and models of the Opera House, people were always present. He often referred to the fluidity of people's movements, individuals and groups of people moving. We see the same thought process in his thinking about colour of the auditorium. He was trying to capture the special nature of going to the theatre. "It's a special time of the day," he said. "Colour at dawn or dusk is special. That's when the colours are in state of transition, from going from dark to light, from cold to warm." So these are the ideas that inspired his choice of colour. and colour was used always in a sense of the scale it would have relative to a human. This is a marvellous photograph he took of Liz. And he's thinking about the Utzon room refurbishment and the tapestry he designed for it, with some smile on his face telling me it was a work of art, about the art performed in the building by the artist of the building. His insistence, this is a maquette of it, my first sighting of it, with some samples of tapestry detailing and colour, and I wanted to take a photograph of it, and he refused to let me until he got a cardboard box and cut out or ripped pieces of paper with figures of human scale so that I could see the work against a human. I'll show a short video clip of our discussions at Khan Liz in Mallorca of the design of the space and his tapestry, but particularly watch in the middle of the video for his concern when explaining a drawing to discover that there was no man in it.
And this is a wall, it's in there, and there you have a perspective of, there's a wall here and a window there, and then you see the end of the window, the wall and the entrance here. It's a very interesting space. You get up the staircase and get down to two walls and suddenly come into this enormous view to the harbor. And then there's this wall here, which I thought I would dare to make a tapestry for. And this tapestry will give us acoustically help, because we have a very fine ceiling for acoustical reasons. We have a big fold, you know, from the concourse.
Yes.
And then, acoustically, we don't have this difficulty with two horizontal planes working together. You have the glass wall and this wall. And if this is absorbing, you can make a timber floor on the floor, which is ideal for cocktail parties. The big window there and the wall here in black. And then you see how the tapestry look like in the room. It fills up to the ceiling and 70 centimeters from the floor and has a movement. And this movement is describing the typical musical procession-like melodies that Carl Philipp Mandelbach, the son of Johann Bach, who had an explosive play of the solo instrument and had the lower, deeper tone to give a procession-like forward moving rhythm and hold together, and sometimes glimpses of explosions or violins. And then you see that when you are in the seven places, no man in there. Very vital wall. And you come round the corner, and not many paintings at all are having a forward moving procession, like character. Most paintings are composed to give you eye a sort of rest. So this is describing, so we should play a bit of the music now.
Thank you.
Whitson also has a very has given us an insight into a very unique way of working for many of us. He comes from that Scandinavian craft-based tradition of working with models, prototypes, working directly with manufacturers and on site. This is an image of him on a scaffold at Carn Felix. He worked with Hogenus Tiles in Sweden for 3 years to achieve the quality of tile and the method of construction that we know and love so much and that gives the building such extraordinary character. But next time you're down there, look at the tiles. Look through the glaze, you can see the terracotta underlay. There was a biscuit, half-baked and washed with glaze and then washed again so that the base material could be seen through the glaze. The glaze was rough, not smooth, like a bathroom tile, so that the high points attracting the wind and the rain would always glisten, even when the tiles were slightly polluted with environmental grime. And we know that the tiles, in terms of the gloss and the matte level, reinforce the structural geometry of the ribs below. I think we know and have talked a lot about the plywood, and these were all prototyped. Monier did, I think I read, 30 sample panels and prototype walls for the selection of the granite. More recently, everything was prototyped in the Utzon Room and Western Foyers, photographed, videoed, and then discussed with Utzon, reviewed, redrawn, adjusted. More recently, working with the weavers at the Victorian Tapestry Workshop, he understood how the work was going to be placed on the loom and the direction of the warp and weft, and gave instructions as a consequence of how the work should be lit. He selected colours and wasn't happy with the gold thread, the explosions of violins, as he called it, until 50 samples were made, and I think he got the right result. If time permitted, one could mention his inspirations from other cultures, more about his additive theories, his understanding of light, and so on. There are so many rich ideas. I've just had time to focus on a few. A significant legacy is the architectural gold, the Opera House Gold Book of 2005. Utzon's work on the Opera Theatre culminated in that, the production of that book. He was after a design worthy of the exterior, with improved acoustics, seat numbers, sight lines, stage areas, backstage facilities, and theatre machinery. He wanted to transform this theatre into something more like his original vision. And he went back to the inspiration of his first auditoriums and recreated a new space for opera in the what was to be the Minor Hall in his scheme. The auditorium, both internally and externally, had the same form, a form that was generated from the cylindrical geometry and a form that adjusted itself for acoustic perfection, as he said, just like a violin. An auditorium that was made from plywood box beams, as he originally intended, with all of the ability for mechanical exhaust, theatrical lighting, and all the technology integral to the structure of the beam, and the decoration integral also to the material. And the auditorium giving more freedom to see between the auditorium and the shell, the underneath of the shell. And an auditorium that had a geometric compatibility in the same family of geometry as the shell. I think I'd like to end, in terms of the legacy, quoting Richard Weston. His work will live as long as architecture is valued. His ultimate legacy is ethical, not formal, a way of working, not a repertoire of form. I think we're still assessing the rich and diverse dimensions of this legacy, and we've still got much to learn from it. I think we do value excellence. The artistic companies that perform at the house clearly understand the value of the Opera House and exploit it to full advantage. It's critical to their survival. The house understands the value of tourism, but finds ever more inventive ways to attract tourists and gain revenue to offset operating costs. The house works the building hard to maximise use. As I've said, it's one of the busiest performing arts precincts in the world. This places increased pressure on the building, and ultimately there's a risk that this compromises the very raison d'etre for the building and its architectural value. And I point to one example of the temporary tents on the forecourt to gain revenue that unfortunately seemed to be a permanent feature. There's insufficient funding, so we haven't learnt much about funding. For maintenance, refurbishments have been a constant problem. Whilst the economic impact of the building to the state and the country is known and quantified, until the house has a reliable and consistent revenue stream of funding, the necessary future works will be uncertain. Past governments have been reluctant to restructure or resurrect the lottery funding, the innovative lottery funding. However, the UK lottery scheme, based on the Opera House experience, since its inception in 1994, has raised some £20 billion for good causes, 18% of which went to arts, sports and heritage projects, and 46% to charitable, health, education and the environment. The funds, as we know, have been used for all sorts of cultural facilities in the UK. £78 million was used in 1999 to initiate the redevelopment of the Royal Opera House in Covent Garden. I think we've learnt a lot about project management of public buildings. Not all good. The Opera House experience, together with other projects, I think understandably convinced many that major public projects need better management to control costs and time, and that the industry and professions, I think, have developed many systems and processes since the house was first opened that apply through our industry today. But it's worth remembering that excellence in the case of the Opera House was not produced by process of systems. It was produced by a process based upon Utzon's natural way of working. It was a system of trial and error and risk-taking, a system of refining an idea through prototyping, a craft-based building process involving both architect and manufacturer, a system of exploring options and taking the time to get it right. This, as we know, is generally in direct contrast to the way we now procure our major public buildings. We seem more interested in process than product. Utzon was afforded exceptional freedom to control all aspects of the project. Are we unhappy with what he gave us? As architects, we must have a more significant say in the process than we currently do, and as we once had. I think we've all been too willing to hand over to others the difficult parts of what we do, to accept partial commissions or roles and contractual arrangements that preclude us from acting in a completely professional way. This inevitably results in a compromise to our art, or in extreme cases, no art at all, just construction. Or ultimately, no profession at all, just a service provider. And consequently, no inspirational legacy to place or culture. It would be inconceivable to have the manager of the orchestra, rather than the maestro, conduct it and make interpretations of the music that suited agendas other than the music. The same applies to architecture, the architecture we want to express our culture. We don't seem to have learnt much about the benefits of public buildings as incubators for innovation. I know there are examples around the country, but generally it's the case. Any brief would give the impression for a new project, would give the impression that these objectives are foremost in the minds of the promoters, with world's best practice objectives, innovation in sustainability, etc., etc. But a management system, funding level, timing and delivery methods, risk management procedures, peer review processes that mitigate against innovation, in the end, encourage the standard, well-proven methods. These risk-averse management systems often seem to go hand in hand with the development of more sophisticated spin and marketing to claim rather than achieve the objectives of excellence. I think we need a process that encourages rather than restricts, a process that recognises the added value and perhaps extra funding, or if not extra funding, extra time needed for these projects to realise their true benefits to the community, culturally, technically, and in the long term, financially. We've become a lot more interested and sophisticated in our view of heritage since the tram shed was demolished. But have we really yet fully appreciated as a community or as planning regulators that the aspirations and excellence of our age has a rightful expression in our city, and that there are occasions, valid situations, where the old can beneficially make way for the new. As a result of the Sydney Opera House, time, cost, politics, I think it took many decades before design competitions were encouraged in Sydney. And that's a sad reality. Fortunately, it's now a lot more common. And certainly, there's encouraging city legislation to procure buildings by competition. But too many, I think, competitions have changed their nature from being open to being more restrictive, to demanding more detailed work in restrictive timeframes from only architects with proven experience. If the Sydney Opera House competition was run today, it would almost certainly not produce the same exceptional result. I think we have much to learn from this great building and from the benefits of Utzon's craft-based way of working. But do we really understand that for Utzon, the starting and the end point of architecture is human experience, not form-making? As architects, we need the time and the authority to develop the full potential of a scheme, its materiality, its texture, its tectonics, its play with light beyond the first images, if we are to create an enduring architecture. This building, the Sydney Opera House, continues to be a rich laboratory of ideas and inspiration, and one that we can tap into. It always rewards serious, open-minded study and inquiry. In conclusion, Jorn, with his unique ideas and approach to architecture, we all know was way ahead of his time. Despite the considerable influence of this building, I believe his major influence on architecture is yet to be felt. The building's true magic is yet to be revealed. It is a testament to the power of his original vision that an architectural idea is so powerful that even when half built by him and the interiors completed by others, it can still claim to be the definitive work of architecture of the 20th century. I and thousands of others never fail to be moved emotionally and spiritually as I approach this building and move up the platform through the public spaces and connect with the harbour and my city. I experience the excitement each time of one of the great sequences in the history of architecture. I would like to end with a glimpse of what the culmination of this sequence could be, an opera theatre rebuilt to Utzon's design, completed in 2005 Gold Book. The animation prepared in my office by the amazing Wayne Dickerson is accompanied by the last aria in the first act of Puccini's Turandot, A per l'ultima volta, for the last time, please, vanquish this dreadful spell. Life is so beautiful.
Thank you.
care.